So because you have already read it so many times with dog and ruminant, so I will just quickly go through the important points. Main bones, scapula, humerus, radius, ulna, carpals, metacarpals, and then fringes, you all know these things. But number of carpals here is 7 to 8. 4 is the proximal row, same as other animals, but in the distal row, first carpal bone is inconsistent. First may be present sometime or may be absent. Then flanges, 3 flanges proximal, distal, P1, P2, P3 for long, short and pocket bone. Then scapula, we will start with the medial bone now. We'll start with the lateral surface. So scapula, spine of scapula, is divided into two parts, and there is a tuberous part, tuber scapulae, and this part gives attachment to trapezius muscles, and this is supraspinatus fossa and supraspinatus, infraspinatus, and they are having the same name muscles here. And both these muscles are supplied by the suprascapular nerve that passes through this area. And you can also see this mass of this nerve over there. Just a brief of the presentation on the slide. All the bony structures are in this blue color. Attachments are in red color. And in the inside, there is a small picture that indicates the joints formed by this particular bone. So this pattern is same on all the slides. And another important difference from the ruminant is absence of acromion process. So absence of acromion process predisposes this suprascapular nerve to injury because it's not covered like ruminant, and that condition leads to sweeney. You might have had this sweeney already. So sweeney, because of damage to this nerve, these muscles infra and supra spinatus muscles, they undergo atrophy, neurologic atrophy. And in such animals, this spine of scapula will be very prominent because of the atrophy of these muscles. Then rest of the thing you know, just near the glenoid cavity there is supraglenoid tubercle that is attachment to bicep radii muscles here. And very much near to this supraglenoid tubercle is this coracoid process. This is a coracoid process that's more on the medial side, and it's also better compared to other animals. Rest all the structures are same as ruminants and other animals, so I don't think there's any need to go in detail. But for your reference, all these bell-level diagrams are from the angel. The next bone is humerus. So it is having this great tubercle on the proximal extremity, great tubercle, which is having two parts. Caudal, cranial and caudal part. This cranial part is palpable and it is known as point of shoulder. So point of shoulder, if you remember, we needed to measure the length of body from point of shoulder to thin bone. Similarly, this deltoid fibrosis, which gives attachment to deltoid muscles, is quite prominent. In general, most of the structures on bones where muscles attach in case of equines are paralleled compared to ruminants. So this deltoid fibrosity is quite quite prominent, and it can also be palpated in the live animal. Then this is the bicipital groove here, which gives the passes for tendon or brachiae. Biceps brachiae, it runs from the supraglenoid worker to the radial tuberosity here. So the belly of muscles lies here and its tendon glide over here. So below this tendon, here it forms the dissipator bursa. This is also important because sometimes you may get inflammation of this dissipator bursa just next to the point of shoulder. Then on the distal extremity, humerus has this condyle which articulates with the radius and ulna, and it's having these epicondyles just above the condyles are the epicondyles, lateral and medial epicondyles. The medial one gives attachment to flexor tendon, medial, SGS, and this gives attachment to flexor carpi ulnaris, the lateral one. And we have already talked about the intertubercular group here, tendons of bicep brachii pass and form the dissipator bursa here. Dissipator bursa that is lined by synovial membrane. Then there is teres tuberosity, mainly on the cranial side, which is very teres major and latissimus dorsi. Muscles attach it to the opposite to the deltoid tuberosity here. And then this brachial group or musculospinal group is common in all species. Then the radius and ulna. So radius from proximal extremity, it articulates with the humerus to form from the elbow joint, or what's other name for elbow joint? Cubital joint. And it is having this radial tuberosity for the attachment of bicep brachii muscle. In case of equines, this ulna does not run throughout the length of radius. In ruminants, it runs throughout the length, it is having two intraosseous spaces. But here, the ulna runs on only to the distal one third, and its remnant is present on the distal part also. So it's only one third. And this upper part is olivernal process, and olivernal process is having a beak-like process known as anconial process. This is anconial process which limits the extension of this joint. And this fibrous part is tuber olivernal, which gives attachment to the tricep muscles. So other attachment for the tricep muscles is this quarter bottom of the scapula. So tricep muscles attach from here to here. So this forms the tricep line, which is the cranial border of the area for the lungs of auscultation. So this forms the dissipator line here. This tuber olivernal or olivernal process is also important. There is a condition in live animals like cat elbow or shoe coil, because at this place it is having skin over it, and then it forms the acquired bursa. And because of inflammation of that bursa, there is a condition that is known as caprine elbow. It's one of the same here that we used for palpation at the university form, and you might have seen this swelling, and that's because of this caprine elbow or shoe coil. So where this bursa is led to, this because of constant irritation from the shoe of rider or toe of the rider, there may be formation of hygroma. But in this spot, it was a more chronic form, and that water was absorbed and it was more fibrous tissue inside. This is a closer look at the same structure. It's also the same year of university form. Next time you may observe it while palpating. Next is the carpal bone that forms the carpus joint. There are 7 to 8 carpal bones. So in the proximal row, radius, intermediate, ulnar, and the ascent lead just behind the ulnar carpal bone. And in the distal row, second, third, and fourth, while first may be present, left hand. If you remember in case of ruminants, this first one is left hand, second and third are fused. So there are only 6 carbon bonds in ruminants, but in case of equine, 7, 8. These carbon bones, they form 3 joints, and the brachial carpal joints between the proximal row and the radial row, then middle carpal between the 2 rows of the carpal joints, and the carpo-metacarpal joint between the metacarpal and the distal row of carpal bones. If you observe, this is the third metacarpal and the second metacarpal and the fourth metacarpal. Just observe that this second carpal bone, it lies directly over the second metacarpal, whereas this fourth carpal, it shares its articular surface with the third metacarpal. So this way, this second metacarpal is the weight for second carpal comes directly over the second metacarpal, because its articular surface is not shared with the third metacarpal, but there its weight is shared. So that's why second metacarpal is more vulnerable to injury as compared to the fourth metacarpal. So all the bones in situ, the carpal bones and the proximal row and distal row, is the palmar view of the joint, and this is the formation of carpal canal. You already know it. Palmar carpal ligament that covers the palmar surface of this joint form the floor of palmar carpal canal, and the lateral wall is formed by the accessory carpal bone, and this flexor retinaculum is dense fibrous connective tissue that forms the roof of palmar canal, carpal canal. And this accessory carpal bone is also an important feature, and it's well favorable in the large animal. It's an important landmark. Also observe here that the palmar border of these bones are rounded to facilitate the flexion of this joint. But this dorsal borders, they are quite square. They are square in nature, they are not rounded. So this also predisposes these bones for the chip fracture, mainly on the dorsal side. Chip fractures are uncommon on the palmar side, but more on the dorsal side. Then flex carpal joint. Out of these 3 joints of the carpus, the antebrachial carpal joint, it opens to the maximum extent. Middle carpal joint opens minimally, but carpo-metacarpal joint doesn't open at all. But these 2 joints, middle and carpo-metacarpal joint, their joint capsules, they communicate with each other, whereas antebrachial carpal joint do not communicate with the joint capsules of other joints. So if you inject some medicine in antebrachial carpal joint, it will not enter to the other 2 joints. But this middle metacarpal joint will share its medicine with the carpo metacarpal joint. Then metacarpal, this is the third metacarpal, that's the main larger bone here, and it's also known as canine bone. It's canine bone, also known as canine bone. And starting from the medial side, it's the second metacarpal and it's the fourth metacarpal, which are small bones, and their distal ends, they form small nodules, and they are also palpable and are an important landmark, particularly for the nerve blocks. This area on the palmar surface on the proximal side is the for the attachment for the interosseous muscle. This interosseous muscle is also known as suspensory ligament, and it's earlier it was known as suspensory ligament, but clinical people are still using this older technology, but older terminology, but not only they are using interosseous muscle these days. On the dorsal side, this metacarpal is having a metacarpal tuberosity there, where this gives attachment to the extensor parvi radialis muscle. So unlike ruminant, proximal phalanx, middle phalanx, and the distal phalanx, also known as long pastern, short pastern, and coffin bone. The joints in between them, the first one is padlock between metacarpal and the proximal phalanx, then proximal interphalangeal joint and distal interphalangeal joint or coffin joint between the coffin bone and the middle phalanx. Each digit is having three sesamoid bones. Two proximal sesamoid bones here. Two proximal sesamoid bones and one distal or navicular bone. Navicular bone because of its shape like a bone. And this bone is also quite important in navicular disease. It may get fracture and also there is a navicular bursa over it. Bound by the distal flexor tendon. Note that the proximal sesamoid bones, they articulate only with the third metacarpal. They do not articulate with the first phalanx. This point is important in your radiographic examinations. So, dorsal and palmar view of the phalanges and some sites for the insertion of superficial distal flexor on the P1 and this deep distal flexor tendon, it inserts on the P3 or the coffin bone. Similarly, the long common distal extensor tendon, it articulates, it attaches to the extensor process. This leg-like process here, that's known as extensor process, and here tendon of common distal extensor attaches. And on the side, there are the palmar process, which gives attachment to the annular cartilage, and this is also important